फिर अपने इसको बड़ा कर दो, चलेगा अभी जब मेरा बारी आएगा। नहीं
कंटिन्यू मैंने देखा है ऊपर दे
तो बड़ा कैसे होगा?
देखा तो इस
बड़ा ऊपर ऊपर ऊपर
देखा तो इस कोई
आ रहा है ना, तो
ना
बड़ा होने का आ रहा है।
आवाज बंद समझ। हेलो कैन यू हियर मी?
यस यस
मैडम।
ओके
ओके बड़ा किसे थोड़ा एडजस्ट करते थे तो
नाउ शिव प्रसाद सर योर कॉलेज कैन बी सीन।
थैंक यू।
वो शेयर किए ना, हमको शेयर नहीं करना, हमको तो इनवॉन को दिए गए स्टाफ से। इसको बड़ा तो नहीं, तो इसको बंद कर दे।
स्क्रीन है नीचे दिशा
में सर, ऊपर आया था वो मिनिमाइज वाला।
हेलो मैडम, माय स्क्रीन इज सीन?
यस सर, यस सर।
स्लाइड्स?
यस सर, आई कैन सी इट। यस
द लॉजिक ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग।
यस यस, आई कैन सी इट सर।
Okay.
The logic of understanding homeopathic therapeutics, Dr. M. A. Udchankar. Yes, I can see it, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
ये तो है, तो मेरा वो वाला किसे आएगा? नहीं आ पाएगा। ऐसे ऐसे करूंगा तो मैं पढ़ूंगा तो मैं देखूंगा इनको कि
नहीं। आप दिखेंगे पर ये नहीं दिखेगा।
ये साइड में तो आ रहा है नहीं? ठीक है, मिनिमाइज तो इसको बड़ा कर दो। मेरा बारी आएगा तब मैं इसको मिनिमाइज करके इसको 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 खुले रहने दो। राइट, बस
नाउ वेयर इज माय स्क्रीन?
नहीं नहीं, इट इज
जस्ट नाउ इट विल कम आफ्टरवर्ड्स व्हेन यू नाउ। उच्चंकर सर हैज टू स्टॉप शेयरिंग द स्क्रीन। आफ्टर ही विल स्टॉप देन यू विल बी एबल टू शेयर अगेन।
So shall I stop now?
Yes, yes. You have to stop because I think so. You are the second speaker, so you'll have to stop now.
Yes, sir.
And now, sir, will be able to share.
Yes.
Hari Purab sir, I can't able to see him. Purab sir.
Yeah, Purab sir is not there yet.
He should come.
Let me stop. Kya lage?
Yes. Now I can able to see the screen of Sri Prasad sir.
Yeah.
Unstable internet connection ke na. Message thode thode aa raha hai. Chalo sahi.
Jo likhi
Can't able to see Purab sir.
I'll call him.
Yes, yes. Call him.
He is talking to someone. બ્રિજેશ ભાઈ આ નવું લિંક બધા જોડે શેર કરવું પડશે? ब्रिजेश भाई
प्रॉब्लम प्रॉब्लम इज गोइंग ऑन दैट मैडम
हाँ जी
आर यू एबल टू कॉन्टेक्ट विद पूरब सर नो
हिज फोन इज कमिंग बिजी
ओके दैट मीन्स ही इज टॉकिंग विद ब्रिजेश भाई
ब्रिज या स्टिल इट इज बिजी So they both are talking, I think so.
Mehta sir told the live has started on YouTube. That means the audience, they can see it through YouTube. But whatever Purav sir and Brijesh bhai.
अच्छा तो पछे हूं ब्रिजेश भाई ने कहो के चालू करावडाई दे
हां हां लिंक इज ऑन
ओके लिंक इज ऑन ओके ओके पूरव भाई जॉइन नहीं થઈ શકતા એટલે તો પછી એ કહે છે કે તમે ચાલુ કરી દો
રાઈટ હિના મેડમ લેટ યુ સ્ટાર્ટ
પેલી સ્પીચ શેર કરેલી વેબિનાર માં કરેલી કે I'll start on my own only.
Yes. You start, I will conclude.
Yes. I'll give it to you for introduction, right? I'll start it.
Welcome speech has been given by me, sir.
Okay. Then I'll give it to you. Brijesh bhai, shuru kare do.
You are live. You can start.
Yeah. Good afternoon, one and all. It gives me immense pleasure on behalf of Parul University to welcome you to this series of webinars. See, as the challenges have come, we have become better and better instead of becoming bitter. So taking this challenge also, we accept it as a change. And in continuation of webinars, we are continuing with the fourth webinar in the series. Since the lockdown, which has affected the entire world, we have started online lectures, and regular online lectures are taken in all colleges of Parul University. Besides that, we have all colleges of Parul University started with a series of webinars. And the entire credit goes to the motivation which is provided and the support which is provided by our president, Dr. Devanshu sir, and our other management leaders, that is Dr. Parul ma'am, Dr. Komal ma'am, and Dr. Gitika ma'am. We are grateful to our leaders who have always motivated us and provided with all online platforms which are possible. It gives me great pleasure that we are trying to make the learning process of the students never to end. And in doing so, we are bringing all the important and eminent fraternity experts to our webinars. Today, we have brought Dr. Udchankar sir and Dr. Shiv Prasad sir to present their presentations and enrich our knowledge. We have four colleges under Parul University, four homeopathic colleges under Parul University. One is Ahmedabad Homeopathic Medical College, which is situated in Ahmedabad. The second one is Rajkot Homeopathic Medical College, which is situated at Rajkot. And there is Jawaharlal Nehru Homeopathic Medical College, which is at Baroda, Parul campus. And Parul Institute of Research and Homeopathy, which is again at Baroda in Parul campus. The four principals of all these four colleges come together and work together to see that none of the colleges' function is hampered in this lockdown. And in doing so, the team of all the four principals are bringing eminent personalities to this platform. Today, with the help of Dr. Panda sir, we are able to bring Dr. Udchankar sir and Dr. Shiv Prasad sir for this webinar. I introduce Dr. Hitarth Mehta, one of our colleagues, who is the principal of Rajkot Homeopathic Medical College, and he is the HOD of Medicine Department. He is the member of Board of Studies of Homeopathic Faculty of Parul University. So I introduce Dr. Hitarth Mehta and welcome him to give the welcome speech for today's webinar. Please, Dr. Hitarth Mehta.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, all. Today on 15th May, International Day of Families, or World Family Day. At this time, the entire world is big family fighting against this dreadful disease, that is Corona. But that cannot stop us from learning. In contribution with the learning process, I welcome you all on fourth webinar organized by Faculty of Homeopathy, Parul University. I welcome today's esteemed guest of speakers, respected Dr. Shiv Prasad sir, and respected Honorable Dr. Mukund Udchankar sir, who are having wide clinical and academic experience in homeopathic system of medicine, which they will share with us today. This series of webinar is the result of tireless effort of our faculty dean, Dr. Gurav Desai sir, faculty dean of homeopathy, Parul University, and is the principal of Jawaharlal Nehru Homeopathic Medical College. Secondly, Dr. Ina madam, principal of Ahmedabad Homeopathic Medical College, Ina Rawal madam, welcome madam. Third, Dr. B.P. Panda sir, principal of Parul Institute of Homeopathy and Research, welcome sir. I welcome them all. Expert can share their views if the audience is learning and have ability to receive. So I welcome all the students, practitioner, intern, and lovers of homeopathy. I hope this webinar will be a great learning session for all of us. Over to Dr. Ina madam.
Thank you, Hita sir, for those encouraging words. Now I would like to invite our second principal, Dr. Panda sir, to introduce our eminent speakers of today. Welcome, Dr. Panda sir.
Thank you, Hina madam. Very good afternoon to the guest speakers and my colleagues and all the viewers of the webinar. I feel proud and honored to introduce our today's speaker on behalf of our faculty of homeopathy, Parul University. Let me introduce our first speaker, Professor Dr. Shiv Prasad K, principal of Father Mular Homeopathic Medical College, Mangalore, an institution accredited with A grade by NAC, Bengaluru, proves its academic excellence in India. He is an eminent academician, HOD, Department of Organon of Medicine, with 29 years of teaching experience with MD Home qualification. As a PG guide, 42 students have already completed PG in Organon of Medicine and doing service for the nation. 6 research papers have been published in H Index Journal as co-author. Completed a book, Homeo Kiran, contains 100 articles published in Sunday Weekly Prajavani. Well appreciated by Radio Doctor, a news broadcast by Department of Ayush in Karnataka State. As an administrator, he was ex-dean of Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Science, chairman of Board of Study. As a social worker, consultant homeopath, he is running Swasti Homeopathy Clinic, ex-president Rotary Club, and appreciated as president, and had received 34 awards for the club during his tenure. Award achieved by Dr. Shiv Prasad, that is Homeo Acharya Award, Karnataka Qualified Homeopathic Association appreciated him with this award. Then another award he has achieved, that is Medscape Award for health and healthcare excellence by the trust of Father Mular, that is Homeo Excellence for the service of Father Mular Homeopathy Medical College. The topic he will deliver today, that is concept of case receiving and perceiving in the clinical practice. Thank you, sir, for giving time us to share your knowledge with all the fraternity. Our second speaker, Dr. Anand Mukul Urchankar. Professor Dr. Anand Mukul Urchankar, Principal KLE University Homeopathic Medical College, Belgavi, Head of the Department of Mater Medica, having 35 years of experience in teaching PG guide. Out of 35, 17 years experience as a PG teacher, a research person in ROTP, Teachers Reorientation Training Program, conducted time to time by Ayush. He was also published 22 scientific paper, more than 16 articles in different journals. He was invited as chairman in the seminar conducted at Abu Dhabi, UAE, on autism in 2nd April 2017. He was also ex-dean of Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Science, Bangalore, board of study member of Rajiv Gandhi Health University, Bangalore. As a host, we have with us Dr. Purab Desai. Due to some technical problem, Dr. Purab Desai could not able to join with us. The principal of Jawaharlal Nehru Homeopathy Medical College, Parul University, dean of homeopathic faculty, Parul University, Dr. Hina Rawal Madam, principal Ahmedabad Homeopathic Medical College, Ahmedabad, Parul University, and chairman board of study, faculty of homeopathy, Parul University.
Dr. Purab Desai has joined recently.
Yes.
Sir, I joined.
Most welcome, sir. I'm very happy that you could able to join. Without you, the webinar is not complete. So Dr. Mehta, principal, Rajkot Homeopathy Medical College and Constituent College of Parul University. The topic delivered by Urchankar sir, that is logic of understanding homeopathic therapeutics. Now, I would like to request Dr. Purab Desai to continue as he has joined. Purab sir.
Yes, sir. See, let me first apologize. Due to some technical errors, I couldn't join in our time. I think the major portion of the introduction part has already been done. So without wasting the time, I request the speakers to start the today's session. So first session will be started by Dr. Shiv Prasad sir. So I request him to start the today's session, sir, please.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, let me thank the organizers from the Parul University for giving me an opportunity to deliver my lecture in this particular webinar. I also bring greetings from Father Mular Homeopathic Medical College, Derlakatte, Mangalore, where we impart UG as well as PG courses. And I'm also thankful to other principals, Dr. Biba Prasad Panda, Dr. Hitarth Mehta, Hina Raval Madam, and Purav Desai, for giving us again an opportunity. We have been in continuous touch with each other to get into this particular program. In spite of the technical glitch usually we have in the online programs, we are starting it off. And my topic for the day is concept of case receiving and perceiving in clinical practice. Now, this is something which is a part of our curriculum in the undergraduate courses as well as when we go into the postgraduate courses. Now, as I understand in the years of my experience with this subject, and also with the people who have been, you know, getting, you know, happier with the organon of medicine, many a time this remains only as a part of our theoretical concept. And as the years pass by, people develop their own methods of, you know, case taking as well as, you know, practicing. But in today's presentation, I would like to, you know, present certain aspects of the variations in whatever is happening in the case taking procedure, but I will stick on to the organon part because this is basically also a training or the lecture series for the students. So
sir, your mic becomes more.
Yeah. Yes. So in the present scenario, what we are finding is that the clinical practice is technology dependent. I just want to start in a different way because whenever we start with organon, we talk about aphorisms and start with aphorisms. So what I have observed, I'll just go to what is the scenario now. In the present scenario, our clinical practice, even in homeopathy, is slowly getting into technology dependent. And lots of gadgets are coming into the, you know, practice. As far as investigations are concerned, photos are concerned, you know, videos, through WhatsApp and, you know, mails. People are getting into a consultation as well as the online clinical practice. We have seen the students getting into this part as more of a, you know, glamour. As we see in the case takings, when we come across our students, since there are a lot of you know, curriculum changes, like today we are having an undergraduate course along with that the post-graduation course. So the basic Hanemannian method, organon based, that is organon aphorisms, whenever you're going into the post-graduation courses with the modern clinical specialty, with lots of you know, authors who have written the textbooks in the recent years. It may be in the medicine when we talk about, you know, the Davidson, Harrison, you know, clinical methods of Hutchison, you know, the Cecil or Hurst, when their literature is there and people are very happy with that. The French index, when we talk about the finer components of it. Then we talk about the surgery, when you talk about Bailey and Love and Das, you know, points like that. From the OBG, we talk about the Mudaliar, Datta, and Shaw, when they talk about the gynecology. In the pediatrics, when we talk about the Nelsons and OP Ghai, and psychiatries, when we talk about, you know, Kaplan's. You know, the good number of literatures, a lot of literature is available, and the students are, you know, going ahead with that, whatever is the specific case-taking methodology related to that. Because the specialty in homeopathy has given an opportunity to study more regarding the nosological classification of disease and the management of the conditions. But as far as we are concerned, when we are teaching homeopathy, case taking, the organon, it has got its everything in it. Hahnemann has, you know, imbibed every component probably that has been in the later years developed by each specialty, and then the specialty has to be considered. As a homeopathic student or as a homeopathic physician, we need to get into the Hahnemannian concept, so that we will understand what basically is required for us. Whatever the clinical subjects speak, clinical subjects give the directions, that's also related to, you know, the practice. At the same time, in the organon, what is there cannot be ignored, and it has to be considered. And I wish that, you know, students develop interest, a special interest in the organon aphorisms. So I'll be running through some of the, you know, the whole section of the case taking from 83 to 104. We'll just have some tips because within half an hour we'll try to, you know, compile and see how it is perceived in our day-to-day practice. Like we talk about, you know, 83 aphorism, I think the self-explanatory, we talk about the freedom from rigidity, sound senses, attention in observing, fidelity in tracing the picture of the disease. Because later when we now go into the materia medica and repertory as, you know, basic subjects, core subjects of homeopathy, we try to, you know, get symptoms. Today when we talk about a clinical condition, the clinical condition gives us a lot of nosological, you know, dimension. But what is required is what we understand of individualization, what we understand of the case in front of us, and what is the individuality. So for that, to become a good case clinician, homeopath requires to have all these qualities. For a student, this is available in the Organon, and then we will go just sliding over the PowerPoint presentations. Other one is when you talk about, we try to collect the history, opinion of the people around him, physicians, observations without intervention. How it has to be done, Hanuman has given. Now, if we go by the acumen of Hanuman, Hanuman has understood and each and every physician or individual's, the level of understanding how to collect symptoms. He is when he started off writing Organon, probably he has considered what was going on in the other school, where the details were collected without much, giving importance to the history. But today, when we see the history, even today, when you talk about a condition like what we are facing now, a pandemic, the history is important not only of the disease, the way we are trying to know each and every component of the individuals, the chain. So that is important to know how it has been. It may be looking very, now it may be looking very something very special for the world. Why this much of history they are asking about a condition? But when we talk about homeopathy, we need to know it, and the student has to focus on this area of collecting the history from different sources. That is important. Hanuman has made a effort, and he has given us the guideline for that in the footnotes also. And how to go about it? Today, it may look very something which is absurd, but when the computers have come today, when the times when we were practicing, when we were studying, when the computer was not there, things to be point by point, line by line, when we were putting down, and today it is made very easy. The new generation may not be knowing it, but Hanuman had that the idea about how it has to be arranged, how it has to be planned. So he has given us a choice, he has given us a chance, he has given us a checklist to get the information so that you can arrange it in a particular way. So he has given it on these aphorisms. When you talk about 85, 86, 87, 88, he has dealt with that. Now, even in a physical disability or a clinical condition which is pertaining to an organ, there are the dispositions of the mind, the type of people who suffer. Now, this is something very special which Hanuman wanted to be understood in every case. So that is also highlighted. And he has also told how to. I'm very sure that the newcomer in the field of homeopathy, in the second year, when the students enter the clinical side, I think they need not have to be anxious. The Organon gives a lot of literature, lot of lead to how to go about a case taking. And if we are able to follow the footnotes as well as the pattern of questions, and then it can be easily understood, the student can be made himself more confident. What we see in the modern textbooks also same thing. Modern clinical subjects also give us the lead to it. So Hanuman during those days, in 1810s, he has given us an idea how to go about those things. He has also said that how to go with special questions, what are needed, how we need to collect some of the symptoms more precisely, because patient may not be understanding what is the purpose of it. Though they are experiencing the modern day the clinical practice, they are asked only about the diagnostic informations, but they are also having something within themselves to speak about the self. So there are good information which they can give, which the student or the patient has to ask. So this is Hanuman's his speciality in presenting this in these aphorisms. And of course, self observations, how much we have to give importance to the different observations of the case. And then coming to the original unmodified picture, I'm sure in the modern day hardly we get something called as original unmodified picture because of lot of therapies, lot of consultants entering into the individual's case. Later on they come to homeopathy. If they come with the first choice, it is nice. But otherwise, most of the times we patients come to us with different therapies. So tracking back to the original unmodified picture is definitely a great task. That is why he has given us again opportunity. He has given us lead how to go about those things by prescribing placebos or waiting for a time. So develop the confidence with the patient, make him more confident in the system, and then give him a chance, and then try to get the original unmodified picture so that a totality can be created. Now these are the areas. These are the aphorisms which speak about something very special. Conjoined malady, for example. we do get cases where there is a combination of the earlier disease, then the medicines, and then something comes up. Now, who can think about it? In 1810s, when Hammer written the first edition of Argyllonox, when he written about the case material, case-taking methodology, he has thought of it. And it is true for the modern-day practice when we are coming into the conjoint malady. It's not that, you know, whatever is presented is the true picture of the disease. That is, something is mixed. And that is definitely is helping us a lot in today's, clinical practice. Collect those symptoms and then see then how it can be managed. If it is harmful, if it is dangerous, it is poisonous type of things, then you try to help them out. Otherwise, again, you give a time to understand the original body picture. Then this obvious cause. Now, don't you think that this is something which is very clairvoyant of Hahnemann to think during those days to see that something within the self which he cannot share with anybody, he can share with the physician. The physician who is the friend, philosopher and guide with whom he or she can share their, the difficulties which they come across, which they can't share with anybody. We have seen in good number of cases, the patients, sometimes they cannot even share it to their own persons, even their parents, they cannot share. They have done something and that guilt or the feeling of, difficulties which are being shared with us. So Hahnemann has given us a lead in our Organon to identify that, and he has given lots of examples so that they are generals. So go into the individual case, even in 21st century, the mind is such a structure, or the mind is such a commodity or a content which needs to be understood better. So Hahnemann has given us a chance in the Organon to try to understand that part also when you are trying to take the case and understand the person. The lifestyle and maintaining causes. Today, even when we talk about the recent pandemic also, when you talk about, there are causes which has to be taken care. The lifestyle has to be taken into consideration. Now, this is again an area where the students are given a lead or the homeopathic practitioners are given a chance to get into that. If you read the aphorisms and the footnotes very clearly, we would get a good information regarding how to, understand this so that it can be applied to a case. In the footnote 87, if it is a female case, the whole gamut of the gynecological and obstetrics conditions and the females when they suffer, what is to be collected? In a chronic condition, it is not that you collect only the suffering as only as a physical entity as the particular organ. If it is a female patient, full information regarding her, the childhood, say, till now, whatever has happened has to be considered. It is something which is can be identified more specifically by a homeopathic physician. And we have seen in good number of cases, the type of the menses, the type of the leukorrhias, the type of the pregnancy, the type of the conditions associated with the pregnancy, that also gives us an idea about the female medicines to be prescribed in female cases. Then the lesser accessory symptoms. Of course, it is again, we have seen in a good number of cases today, their patients have forgotten. That is very important because that has become part and parcel of their life. And then they are able to just manage with that. And as a homeopath, we need to know them because that gives us a characteristic, component to the case. Then again, how somebody is having a temperament, like the mind setup, hypochondriacs and indolent patients who are sharing, and how to handle those patients and how to get the best out of them. That is also mentioned. Now, each component can be demonstrated in our clinical practice. If we are getting into cases, we are able to see this type of people even in the 21st century. It is not something beyond our experience. They are all there. And in chronic and acute cases, how the symptoms can be collected. A student need not be worried when the aphorism number 5 speaks about the fundamental cause and the exciting cause, and then arriving at it. And when you come to the later aphorisms, when you go for the case taking, it is beautifully written how it has to be collected, how it has to be made known, to the patient. It is very important, and then collect them so that you make a best understanding of the patient. Then in acute cases, he clearly says that everything is fresh in memory. You do not worry. They keep on giving us the information without sometimes asking for it, because that is what they're suffering from. In chronic cases, they need to, the physician has to be highly skilled, in order to collect the information. He has given those descriptions. And now the current situation, we're talking about the case taking in epidemic and sporadic. So I'm talking about, we are all talking about the 1810s when this particular, the concept was put up by Hahnemann of handling cases in the epidemics, sporadic cases, the acute and the chronic. And that holds true even today. okay, when we are coming across epidemics as well as pandemics, how many of it we are not treated as homeopaths, you know, when compared to the other medicines who are still finding out, trying to work out for the vaccines, they're trying out for some of the medical measures, which they have to do an experimentation, they have to redo the experimentation, then get into that. But we as homeopaths, we have got in our material medical already proved drugs, and they are also found to be very good in our day-to-day practice. And this is the area where he has told us how to collect a symptom at the level of if there is an epidemic or a sporadic case, or even today when you talk about endemic, the pandemics. And this is something which we can find in Organon, the classical or traditional part of it. Not that it cannot be ignored. It becomes of a great importance. The student has to be, focused on these aphorisms, in a very, very closer manner, and then try to understand that. And ultimately, the recording, the case data, which has to be documented, that is very, very important, because that is what we are lacking. He also said that during those days also, he said that in the footnote, he says that, people are not bothered about, what is the, data to be collected. Every time when the patient comes up, they don't know what has happened in the past. So today, since we have got a documentation and we have got the data processing through the, computers, it becomes so easy. I always advise, the students to go for the softwares or the database. So it is very easy to know a patient in any number of years of the practice. You know the past of the patient, and then you can handle it in a better way when it comes to the present also. Now, how to perceive? Now, Hanuman has said you collect the data. Now, collecting the data is one component in each and every area. It may be any specialty. It can be, today's specialty of the medicine, pediatric, gynec, surgery, or psychiatry. Any clinical condition, these are general guidelines have to be considered. Many times what I have found is that we miss the, the basic clinical type. Because in homeopathic way, clinical type is a classification of diseases. We give a question in the examinations asking for the classification of disease. But classification of disease itself is the, clinical types as far as the homeopathy is concerned. The consultant need to, as a physician, we need to know what type of case we are treating, whether it requires really therapy, and what type of a therapy, and how it has to be correlated and conceptualized, and then getting into the reality part. Nosological classification, and then going ahead with indisposition, surgical diseases, and dynamic diseases. Many a time we find that surgical diseases or the conditions which are having the one-sidedness, or we'll see in the later slides, we invariably we are focusing the students to prescribe a constitution and then end up in trouble without knowing what exactly is happening. So what is required is trying to understand the clinical type as given in the Organon. So Hanuman has given this, when he says about, perceiving a, the case taking is focused on what type of a disease we are treating with or handling or, dealing with. Whether it's acute disease, if it is acute, what type of it? Individual, sporadic, epidemic. Let us be very clear when the case is being taken, and then the end of it, what we are having in front of us. Whether it's an acute disease, if it's acute disease, Hanuman has given the definition for it. He has given us the idea. The nosological class names are different. Whatever the clinical types we are hearing in the clinical side, they are all there. But as far as the condition, it appears sporadic type, epidemic type, endemic type. It's the chronic diseases when we talk about the fully developed symptoms and with a few symptoms. Chronic diseases don't appear like as we find so easily. Chronic disease has to be struggled into. We have to struggle to get the information and make the patient understand, and then make our reality and then prescribe. So even in chronic diseases, what type of a case is in front of us and how it has to be handled. So chronic diseases with the fully developed symptoms, when they are non-miasmatic, we have seen the miasmatic we have seen. Again, he has given us a lead, the pseudochronic as well as the artificial chronic diseases. Again, we find a good number of conditions in today's practice which is belonging to this section rather than classical miasmatic disease, because of changing trends, changing lifestyle, lot of allopathic medication or any medications, the suppressive line of management, lot of surgeries done on that, and the body constitution changes, and then the picture of the disease changes, the expression changes, and there are a lot of difficulties or obstacles we come across when we treat. So we need to know whether this case is of a, because of the pseudochronic nature, whether it is artificial coronary distress. If the student or if the consultant is very clear about it, I think that can be handled better, so that we can say this is our limitation. This is the way we can handle it, and this can be managed. At the same time, when you come to miasmatic, a very strong understanding about the miasms. I'm sure his lifetime is not enough to understand these ideas about Hahnemann. Maybe the names, the terminology may be sometimes troubling us, that psoriasis, psychosis, syphilis, you know, like that. But the way we are supposed to understand the miasms and then go into the case, that is very important. The conceptualization and then application in the day-to-day practice, it has to be dealt with the, you know, our curriculum, and then the students have to be understand regarding this. So the classification is again single when we talk about the miasms, psoriasis, psychosis, syphilis, and tubercular, and the complex. Now again, the component of it, how the patient has come out with the single miasm or the complex miasm, is left to the physician's you know, judgment. Now that judgment comes only with the our, you know, knowledge based, you know, understanding with the different authors who have come out with the, their views on the miasms, starting from Hahnemann till even to the modern days, you know, consultants, including Dr. Kausar, when he speaks about that, or whoever is, you know, consultant who is practicing, they have got a view about it. So the concept of Hahnemann regarding the philosophy miasm is there in everybody's, but the expressions trying to find the symptoms are different. The student has to get into this basic mode and then get into the, you know, the changes which are found to be, we call it as variations in their, you know, expressions. This is the few symptoms is again another component. We said, you know, we have got one-sided diseases and local maladies. Many a time I have found, you know, students in the initial part, they get confused because the clinical exposure is so much, and with a lot of you know, information available through the literatures in the modern day clinical practice as well as investigations, students get confused whether it can, you know, can be managed, whether it can be controlled, it can be managed by homeopathy, whether it leads to, you know, the natural expression of disease, whether it goes for obstructive, you know, the suppressions. Like we have seen, you know, some conditions when they are coming out with only some locations. They are weak. We can see only that condition. Like say, suppose if it is a fibroid, suppose if it is a, you know, tumor, suppose if it is something to some benign, you know, conditions and the malignant conditions. When they are being treated by other school, see, the patient part is also ignorant about what is happening to them. They are given for a treatment. After they come to homeopathy, finding that homeopathy is good for that. And then when we are treating, we are also finding it difficult to understand what is the nature of the disease, whether it has gone for one-sidedness, whether it has gone for the local malady also. This becomes important when you are perceiving, when you are trying to understand the disease with the few symptoms. This is also important to know what is the level of, you know, the phase as well as the symptomatology which is in, available in these conditions. So what they're perceiving, the important thing what we come across is that effective learning, you know, observations are very important. Along with the, you know, other physician, if it is there, video clippings with the consent of the patient. Because when you're understanding the disease from the organon point of view, as far as the, you know, case taking is concerned and the clinical classification or the disease classification is concerned, and with whatever the information available in the modern day medical practice, when you're putting them together, as a physician, when we talk about unprejudiced observer, you know, trying to know the individual as a patient, as an individual, or characteristic symptoms, we may make mistakes. So what is most important in the, you know, case receiving as well as perceiving the disease is to understand the self. The physician should be having that type of a you know, quality in him to become an unprejudiced observer. Now this is what is starts from the beginning. So if there is an observer, okay, with the physician's case taking, if at all there are some mistakes, it can be initial part of it, and then later also we can do it. And today we are helped by, you know, some of the virtual, you know, data technical support, where we can identify and we can get an idea how this can be, you know, handled. So observations are important for effective learning circumstances. Key factor in education and training. See, today the what I know, what I have treated, maybe not dying with me. What I know, what I have done can also be transferred to the next generation by our, you know, documentations, by our sharing with the, you know, the new generation. the new generation, as I understand, many a time when they come to second year, they find it sometimes very difficult to pick up what we are trying to make them understand, because they are very comfortable with the whatever the modern clinical staff or clinical data is available. But when come to homeopathy, trying to understand the individual is becoming a problem. To know that we need to have a learning situation where we need to create, you know, the physician as well as the observer component, so that the students go through that. When they are going through that, it's not only that they just look into the matter, but they are also trying to internalize, okay, what is an experience. So that is a very key important factor in the education and training. And physician also becomes aware even after many years of experience. I'm sure we are all not very experts in every case becomes a new case. We need to identify in everyday practice, we are supposed to implement or apply whatever Hahnemann has told in the Organon as far as the case taking concerned and classification and understanding the disease is concerned, so that we make every effort to become an unprejudiced observer. Now, there are some tools by means of which we can identify, probably the time is not enough, but there are technology by means, techniques by means of which we can do it. Like we adopted some methods of the Institute of Clinical Research, Mumbai, Dhavlesh Institute, when we had that process of case taking by having observers. Then we are understanding the transaction records. Then we are trying to understand through the clinical session evaluation form, trying to understand how the student or the physician is doing when a case is going on. Different methods are there. This is what we are doing it, so that we can make that more effective teaching learning methodology. Any institution can adopt their own way of handling this type of education methodology, so that ultimately our purpose is to make the Hahnemannian literature more practicable in the day-to-day practice. It is not that somebody tells on a particular section of the time, this is good for this homeopathy should be practiced like this, and later on somebody comes out and tells something else. That should not be the criteria. There is enough literature. There is enough sharing of the concepts or the ideas by Hahnemann. The only thing we need to pick them up and then put into practice. That should be the purpose, so that we can make best use of Hahnemannian literature. So as Elizabeth Wright mentions, case well taken is half cured. Every time you take a case, you are entering into a new world. Now this is in short, in brief, I can just make a presentation about the concept of case receiving and perceiving in clinical practice. Students can carry some information regarding this, which they can develop, and every slide becomes a literature or the lecture of hours together. But trying to put into practice any day, any time in our life, it may be useful, and go back to Organon and then see where I can get some information and I can do something good to the suffering humanity by applying all the guidelines of case taking and perceiving, understanding, and then treating the case. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Udav, sir, please continue. Thank you, Shiv Prasad, sir.
Thank you.
Now I would like to call Dr. Udchankar sir to continue with the presentation. Dr. Udchankar sir, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My voice is clear?
Yes, sir.
I'll just share. Are my slides available?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon. At the outset, I bring fraternal greetings from our Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Registrar of KLE, deemed to be university. My topic today is logic of understanding homeopathic therapeutics. Well, the origin of thought or conceiving this idea came to me when I encountered certain things. Being in the field of teaching for last almost 37, 38 years, we have been involved in not only in teaching evaluation. When we evaluate the papers, especially of therapeutics, let's take an example that if a student is asked to write indications of sabaina and dysmenorrhea, or indications of arsenic albin typhoid, or indications of arnica and injuries, the student used to write only arnica and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The lines are 4 or 5 symptoms of arnica. Many a times I did not have a logical linkage in these things. When we apply to this particular thing, our knowledge of materia medica or Gunon, or in a live situation to the patient, the understanding of materia medica and understanding of therapeutic and understanding of the logic of application of applied materia medica on a live, in a live situation, needs something else. That is what came to my mind. Now, what am I going to raise is not something new. Many of you may be knowing as my colleagues in the teaching. And I am raising things the way I looked at it, being in the field of teaching almost 38 years. At the outset, let me request all of you to make your thoughts totally blank. And let us both together go through this small journey of, say, half an hour's time. Later, I leave the topic to you to explore. Maybe you may come out with something more innovative things than me. Let us all together work for the betterment of the science, upliftment of the science. And at times during my talk, the things may appear absolutely mundane, but I feel they are vital. Therapeutics is, in a common parlance, a branch of medicine concerned with the treatment of diseases. Let me go step by step. Things to ponder upon, think upon. With law of similars existing, should there be a separate branch for therapeutics? A mute question that arises. Couple of questions need to be answered. What we need to know when we are trying to understand the logic of understanding of therapeutics? Is it the diagnosis? Is it the condition? Is it the remedy? Is it the miasm? Is it a symptom? Is it a patient? And my answer to all this would be, we need to know all these things. Then, if this is the logic, most of the times, as Shiv was mentioning, that we need to hone our skills in teaching. Basically, in teaching technology or in teaching, to my professional colleagues, I always ask them, do you want to serve a fish or teach them fishing? What is to be learned by the students? Is it to receive a served fish or learn fishing? Why do I correlate this here? In a classroom, we teach therapeutics for a clinical condition and give them a list of remedies with their indications. That becomes only a fish for that person. or it becomes a served fish for that day. Do we really go into an understanding where the student knows how logically this particular medicine, how logically this particular remedy can be applied to a particular condition? I believe in it strongly. As a teacher, I believe strongly in one logic. If you serve a fish, you serve him for a day. If you teach him fishing, you serve feed him for life. Our whole motto has to be on one thing, that we need to teach them the logic to come to a logical conclusion in any scenario, in any clinical condition. Maybe if you are just writing therapeutics for a condition, or maybe when this particular thing is logically applied in a live situation on a live patient. The reason for this, many times I find the success stories, many times when we attend conferences, people tell about their success stories. I treated such and such case, blah, blah, blah. And they give the treatment, they give the remedy. This I selected such an X, Y, Z, A, B, C. I don't want to go to the details. But nowhere they mention the internal or inside logic behind that particular conclusion of that simulimum. And that is the basic reason why I thought that we need to do something for this area and come out with something else, something new for students and for clinical application on a live situation. With only conservative line of treatment, should there be a separate branch for medicine, surgery, OBG, and should there be a separate logic for understanding therapeutics? There should be branches for therapeutics, but the logic remains same because we are on a basic principle of symptom similarity or similia similibus curantur. A condition. Now let us explore things in a different way. For a student, we are not asking him to treat a condition on a patient. For a student, when we ask him write 5 remedies for the typhoid fever, here it is a condition that we are giving to the student to write. And next comes a patient. When the patient is being treated, we need to apply this logic of understanding of therapeutics to a patient. But in both the cases, what is similar is remedy. This remedy has to be arrived at logically when the left part of condition is being treated, or condition is being narrated in a theoretical class, and a patient being treated in a live situation. That particular thing will be slightly or different in understanding. Let us move further in our journey. Then what is the logic? Logic of this whole subject is to know the condition, the pathology of that condition, the natural course of that condition, the materia medica totally, the drug substance of materia medica drug, the physiological action of that drug, the patient at last, and the most vital thing. Then, if we need to know all these things, how do we go about it? The understanding now onwards, I will focus. When we need to understand a condition, or a student is asked to write therapeutics for a condition in a theory paper, or a student is asked to write the indications of a particular drug in a particular condition, how his approach should be, and how we as teachers to teach him the logic to reach that particular thing, what exactly is the basis of that particular drug being indicated in a particular condition. And the second component will be, when in live situation, when we are applying our knowledge of materia medica, that time, how are we going to apply this particular knowledge of our materia medica principles of Organon on the other side, which is the base of management, and then the real application of the things. When we consider a disease condition for the therapeutics, we need to consider all above points, the condition, the pathology, the course, materia medica, the substance, the medicine, and the patient. The whole thing needs to be considered when we are talking about therapeutics of a disease condition where there is no live patient in front of us to treat. Second component is, when we apply it to a patient in a live situation, let us see the details of these applications one by one. The condition now, let us explore. Know the symptom and its pathogenesis. The pathology, the natural course of the disease, the complications of a disease condition. Now, these are the things which should be known to us, and that is what Shiv was also mentioning in his talk. Knowledge of disease, and when it comes to knowledge of physician, knowledge of disease is one of the most vital component a physician should possess. When it comes to a particular symptom, let us now explore, look at this particular thing. We, as a teacher for Organon, Shiv may say objective symptoms, subjective symptoms, etc. But we also say the same thing. But when we come to the analysis of this particular symptom, let us see. Let us take some symptoms and see and how to go about it. One, vomiting. Now, when we take vomiting as a symptom, vomiting can be a symptom presented by a patient. Now, when we are trying to apply as a therapeutics to this particular symptom, we need to understand couple of things. One is, as the drugs and their application in as far as vomiting is concerned, vomiting presented by live patients as far as their clinical presentations are concerned. Let us take the clinical conditions with which the patient may present. Vomiting may be presented in various kinds of things. Vomiting can be there because of metabolic reasons. Vomiting can be there because of local regions of the GI tract. Vomiting may be central, vomiting may be localized. Let us now take, for example, vomiting presented by a patient of gastritis or a vomiting presented by a local lesion in the GIT. Their nauseating feeling that comes will be relieved after vomiting. Nausea relieved after vomiting. That is how the patient of Nux vomica presents. And in case of ipecac, there is vomiting. We read that sentence, which is red line symptom in ipecac. Nausea not relieved by vomiting. Why this particular thing appears here? Let us bifurcate this two as far as the vomiting reason as clinical entity is concerned, vomiting as a manifestation in ipecac is concerned. Let us take a clinical condition. Vomiting centrally, when vomiting center is excited, a nausea will not be relieved by vomiting. Go to ipecac. Ipecac physiologically acts on medulla oblongata. That is how we read in materia medica. And vomiting center is situated in medulla oblongata. And when this particular center is excited, the nauseating feeling starts. And this being not a local cause, it is central excitement, nausea will never be relieved by vomiting in ipecac. That is how the clinical presentation, as far as the clinical condition is concerned, we need to differentiate. As far as ipecac as a drug is concerned, we need to understand. Let us go to another symptom, headache. Now, headache per se may present in many conditions. Headache may be a metabolic, may be salt depletion, may be any kind of a simple viral infection to a complicated one, or it may be a space-occupying lesion in the skull. Now, I'll just give an example. A child which was about 11 years old came to us with headache and vomiting. Headache and vomiting, people started treating it as child migraine. And child migraine was treated. the patient, the boy did not respond to anything. Under these circumstances, it was referred to a senior pediatrician who took an MRI. Then it was revealed that there was a huge tumor inside and that the child succumbed to that particular thing after 2.5 months. In this particular thing, what I would like to stress upon is when we are imparting this knowledge in the classroom, we need to emphasize on these areas and then make the student or make a learner to understand the various ways the headache presents and where our drugs can be used, where our drugs do not have any place or their limitations start. This particular thing needs to be emphasized in a classroom teaching. Breathlessness. Now you take breathlessness. When breathlessness patient comes to me, breathlessness may be because of anything. It could start from anemia, it could start from asthma, it could start from respiratory causes, it could start from cardiac causes. Breathlessness itself is a presentation on the basis of breathlessness. Any case of breathlessness is likely to be anxious, is likely to be fearful, is likely to have sweating, is likely to have certain anxiety, anguish feelings. Now, under these circumstances, if we only take this into consideration on the face value and think drugs like carbamazepines, arsenic, etc., etc., now that may not be suitable. We need to go into the depth of this particular breathlessness, why breathlessness, and a clinical exploration of this. And now let us take another example, retrosternal burning. Retrosternal burning is a manifestation of hyperacidity, is a common parlance. Now, any case of retrosternal burning may not be suitable for Robinia, may not be suitable for Nitrimphos, may not be suitable for Carbo-Veg, Phosphorus, Bismuth, etc., etc., etc. Under these circumstances, student needs to be appraised that retrosternal burning may be a presentation of something else also, like anterior wall myocardial infarction also may present as retrosternal burning. Now, under the serious circumstances, our limitations needs to be appraised to the children in a classroom, especially when they come to the clinical classes and higher up. Pain in abdomen, another thing. Pain abdomen, our abdomen is supposed to be, as teachers of surgery or as teachers, we teach the patient, the students, in a pain in abdomen or abdomen is a Pandora's box. If we list out the causes for pain in abdomen, there will be around 60 to 65 causes for pain in abdomen. Now, what is the cause for pain in abdomen? How the patient presents for pain in abdomen? And what could be a serious implication of this particular pain in abdomen? That particular thing needs to be appraised to the student and where a particular drug needs to be applied. Any pain in abdomen relieved by bending double may not be colocynthol based. And here, we need to teach the students or make the learner to learn to be totally unprejudiced, unbiased, and explore the causes. Whenever a patient comes with pain in abdomen, he must always explore why pain. Now, this could be one of the things. There could be extradural or subdural hematoma, which may cause vomiting. And under these circumstances, if only vomiting is being treated, it's likely to be a disaster. Pain in abdomen, always rule out the cause. Cause there could be something alarming. Now, this could be one of the things. Sudden perforation, especially endangered in purgation, of appendicular perforation or any perforation for that matter could be a thing with which the patient may present. And if we do not explore, if we do not go into the causes of this particular abdominal pain, we may land up into a problem. Now, it could be a ruptured ectopic gestation where our drugs do not have any role to play. It could be a ruptured uterus. Our drugs do not have any role to play. The pathology needs to be understood. Why pathology of a disease condition needs to be understood? Because we need to know this only because let us take one condition and see. For example, a very common condition of typhoid fever. If we understand the pathology and pathogenesis of typhoid fever and tuberculosis for that matter, malignancies for that matter, if we take them, if you look at this particular thing, sudden perforation may be a complication of typhoid fever. We need to understand if a patient who is under the treatment of typhoid fever, suddenly he starts developing acute abdominal pain. And if we are not aware that this could be one of the complications of typhoid fever, we are likely to land up into the problem. Now, what I'm trying to tell you here, or what I'm trying to appraise here, that under these circumstances, every manifestation needs to be explored categorically by the student, and that particular thing needs to be made, needs to be told to the student or taught to the students. This could be a shadow in the lung. The complications of that, some examples may make it clear. In typhoid fever, perforation is one of the complications. Pyelonephritis could be one of the complications. Meningitis could be one of the complications. Now here, if we do not go into these intricacies, if we do not appraise the student during that in the therapeutic classes that these are the possibilities, and this is where the approach has to be a little different in as far as these things are concerned, the thing is likely to be a little tricky. Now, in any case of perforation, an erect X-ray abdomen may show the gas under the diaphragm. If the student gets to know the gas under the diaphragm is a perforation sign, because right dome of the liver is higher than the left dome of the right dome of the diaphragm is higher than the left dome of diaphragm. Air is likely to go up and settle between the diaphragm and the liver, give like a moon shaped shadow or gas under the diaphragm. Under these circumstances, these investigatory procedures may be in a position to clear so many things. Natural course of the condition. Let us see with the examples like thromboangitis obliterans, or otherwise we call it as Berger's disease. I still remember a case being treated by a physician in a hospital, and the patient presented with burning pain in the soles, burning, claudication, etc., etc., all manifestations of thromboangitis obliterans or Berger's disease. Now, the pain one fine morning disappeared. Disappearance of a pain in a thromboangitis obliterans may not be taken as a good sign, because gangrene must have already settled. Now, that particular thing needs to be told to the students, or students need to be appraised regarding these things. Head injuries. Now, any head injury for that matter needs to be explored into. Now, head injuries, the moment head injury comes, we couple of drugs, we get rate, arnica, cicuta virosa, natrum sulf, etc., etc. Under these circumstances, the patient may get all right, and slowly the extradural hematoma may settle. After 4 or 5 months, the patient may go into pressure symptoms and leading to central nervous manifestations and come out with a certain different condition. Now, the vital thing that we need to concentrate is to know materia medica. What do we need to concentrate on in understanding materia medica as far as application is concerned? The substance we need to understand, what is it made up of? The action of that particular medicine needs to be understood. The application needs to be understood. Let us go to these examples of creosote, Antimtan, Ipecac, Mucosol. Now let us analyze these drugs, 4 drugs, with these 3 steps. Now let us go with creosote. Now what is the substance of creosote? It's the first line in Boric says, creosote is mixture of phenols. It acts on mucous membranes, especially of lower genital tract. And the second thing that creosote is capable of doing is it decomposes the body fluids. Hence, the lower genital tract is prone for those cauliflower-like growths, malignant tendencies of malignancies. That is what we read in creosote, and that is what exactly happens in cervical carcinoma. The lady presents with her vaginal discharge, which is offensive. Now, go back to creosote. creosote being a mixture of phenols, which leads to decomposition, and that is the reason why the leucorrhea or the vaginal discharge becomes offensive. So offensive vaginal discharge with action on the mucous membrane leading to cauliflower-like growths is creosote. That is what needs to be appraised. That is what needs to be linked into. That is how the application part needs to be taught when we are teaching Materia Medica to the students, especially third and fourth year. Now let us come to antimtart. Antimtart is a drug, tartar emetic. It was anciently used as emetic agent. And antimtart acts on pneumogastric nerve. And antimtart leads to a couple of things. Number one, it increases the secretions of lung or lung parenchyma, and it decreases the motility or it decreases the motile function of respiratory apparatus. And that is the reason why we get two manifestations. One, in antimtart, there is death rattle because of large collection of fluid or large collection of sputum. The collection is because of its enhancement or increase capacity to increase the secretions. And patient is unable to expectorate. He has to cough very vigorously throughout to throw out the expectoration. Basically, the reason being the respiratory apparatus is weakened by antimtart, and that we get, though there is a lot of collection in the lungs, and rattling sound is there whenever the respiratory sounds are heard of antimtart patient. Is in Materia Medica, it is very clearly written that you can hear to the respiratory rattle from the door. Now, though it is little exaggeration, this needs to be emphasized to the student when he is trying to apply the knowledge of Materia Medica as far as the respiratory tract indications are concerned in antimtart. Now, say for example, next drug we take up, Ipecac. Ipecac acts on two things. One is medulla oblongata. Second is pneumogastric nerve. As far as pneumogastric nerve effect of Ipecac is concerned, it remains same as antimtart. It increases the secretion. It increases the secretions of respiratory mucosa. And this particular drug does not weaken the respiratory apparatus like antimtart. And that is the reason why in Ipecac, you do not get that particular manifestation of very scanty expectoration. Patient is able to expectorate easily. And Ipecac has got action on medulla oblongata, and that is the reason persistent nausea, not relieved by vomiting, becomes a red line manifestation. Coming to a very deep acting antisyphilitic drug, Merxol. When we try to understand Merxol, it is an element, mercury. It acts basically on the glands and does two things. It acts on the gland. One, it increases the secretions of every gland, and it increases the size of the gland. And that is the reason why you get enlargement of glands and increased secretions of the glands. Now, let us correlate these two factors, these two actions, into the symptoms manifested or indications of Materia Medica. We get tongue as a musculoacinar organ. The acinar part or glandular part gets enlarged, and that is the reason the tongue becomes large and flabby. When the tongue becomes large and flabby, it is not being accommodated properly in the dentures. And that is the reason, as an effect, you get imprints of teeth on the tongue. And because an acinar part is excited as far as the secretions are concerned, there is excessive salivation and enlarged large flabby tongue become the manifestations. As far as the sweating is concerned, sweat glands also are exaggerated, or they also increase their secretions, leading to excessive perspiration. Now, excessive perspiration in case of mercurius, we have got another manifestation. Perspiration does not relieve the complaint. perspiration does not relieve the complaint, basically because Merxol is syphilitic. When you go to psoric, syphilitic and psychotic things, psorics are relieved by natural discharges. Naturally, you will get perspiration relieving the complaint in a conite, which is basically a psoric drug. And patient having natural discharges, not relieving the complaint, which is basically a syphilitic thing, that is what you get in Merxol. Whereas in case of Medorinum, relieved by leucorrhea, which is an unnatural discharge, I am not talking about a physiological or a per se definition of leucorrhea, because leucorrhea per se is defined as normal secretion or natural secretion. I'm not talking about that, but an abnormal secretion per vagina relieving the complaint of Medorinum becomes psychotic. That is the way in which these particular medicinal substances need to be taught into with a proper analysis of every symptom, why this symptom is developed, how this particular symptom needs to be correlated in a clinical condition, and how this symptom needs to be correlated into a patient when a live patient is treated by us. Let us move our journey a little further. We must know the miasmatic background of the condition, miasmatic background of the patient, and miasmatic background of the remedy. Now let us analyze these things. Take only one condition. Say, suppose, for example, we take a condition of bronchial asthma. Bronchial asthma as a condition is very clearly known that a condition of bronchial asthma is psychotic in nature. And when it comes to application of a remedy, look at a very simple scenario. In regular practice, when a patient comes out with acute asthmatic attack, most of the times, or many of the times, arsenic ulb is one of the drug indicated. And arsenic ulb does relieve an acute episode of asthmatic attack. Now the question comes, where arsenic ulb is not a simulimum for psychosis, very clearly written, how does it relieve the acute manifestation of an acute asthmatic attack? Go back to aphorism number 39-43, where it is again, what happens when two dissimilar diseases meet together in the body? The stronger one will rule, or stronger one will make its presentation. Now this particular acute episode or exacerbation of a bronchial asthmatic attack was an activated psoric manifestation, and that is why arsenic ulb is capable of relieving to some extent in case of this particular thing as an anti-psoric drug. This particular reference I'll give you at the end of my explanation. Now, asthma being psychotic, arsenic is not being psychotic. Arsenic will not be in a position to take a curative measure in case of bronchial asthma at all. Now, when acute asthmatic episode is relieved by arsenic, arsenic acts as a palliative agent there. It's only a temporary relief that is given. And if at all you want to reach to the depth of that particular asthma to bring out a curative phenomena in the patient, that is the time when you have to go to an anti-miasmatic drug like Natrum Sulf or Thuja. And here, the explanation is very clearly given in Kent's Materia Medica, Lectures on Homeopathic Materia Medica by Kent. Not under drug picture of arsenic, you read the drug picture of Thuja, and in third or fourth paragraph, he states this particular thing, that arsenic acts as a palliative and relieves for a temporary period, and it acts like aconite. That is what is the sentence there. It acts like aconite in this particular episode. Now, the miasmatic background of the condition is equally important. Miasmatic background of the patient is equally important, and miasmatic background of the remedy is also equally important when we want to reach to a curative state of a condition. Now let us make the journey a little further. This is basically for the students. This particular slide is basically for the students. When the students are writing answer to any therapeutic question, like write indications of 5 drugs or arsenic albin typhoid, write indications of Lilium trigerinum in dysmenorrhea, or write indications of XYZ in a particular condition. Now, what are they supposed to write? How it has to be? This is the mute point which originated this thought in my mind. The first thing that a student should write is relevance of that particular medicine